Hello there, and welcome to Tusken Radio. I am Drew Grech.
I'm Owen Grech.
And I'm Angus Allan.
And today we have an absolutely packed hour-long show. We are talking about David S. Goyer writing two unproduced Star Wars movies. We're talking about Andor. We were talking about Skeleton Crew. We were talking about the writer's strike finally coming to an end. We have some Star Wars pitches, and we have Ahsoka Part 7, as well as predictions for next week's big season finale. All that and more right after this. So it seems like every day now we are hearing from directors and writers who were at one point attached to direct a Star Wars film. Zack Snyder, James Mangold, Josh Trank, all were at some point attached to Star Wars. Well, screenwriter David S. Goyer on the Happy, Sad, Confused podcast has just revealed that he wrote two unproduced Star Wars films and that one of them would have been directed by Guillermo del Toro.
Who is Guillermo del Toro?
So Guillermo del Toro...
name is familiar.
Yeah, he was... I don't know like his filmography off the top of my head. I know that his Pinocchio film, yeah, the Shape of Water, Best Picture winner,
Pacific Rim also.
Pacific Rim, his Pinocchio film, I believe, won Best Animated Film at the Oscars this past year. But great director, he was going to direct a Star Wars film that was written by Goyer, and Del Toro took to Twitter to say, or X to say, true, can't say much, maybe two letters J and BB. Is that three letters? In like 2017, there were rumors that there was going to be a Jabba the Hutt movie.
That's interesting.
There were rumors that the next Star Wars film after Episode 9, because this was before Solo came out, so like there was still like, I don't know, excitement about new Star Wars movies. Yep. Joke, of course. But I remember it was rumored that there was gonna that like films that were in development were a Kenobi movie. I believe the Boba Fett film was still in development at that time. There were some rumors about a Yoda movie.
That would have been interesting to see. I think a Jabba movie would have included like his rise to being a gangster. You know, there actually was a Jedi that was a Hutt that quickly turned to the Sith.
Yeah, I have a feeling that if this movie were to have happened, it would have kind of have acted as a sort of sequel to Solo, because Solo ends with, you know, Han and Chewie going off to Tatooine to find that big shot gangster, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, the second movie, which we are going to get in some form, hopefully.
From Solo?
No. He wrote a script treatment for an Origins of the Jedi movie set about 25,000 years before the events of the films.
Wow.
Which we do, of course, know that James Mangold, who is hot off of Indiana Jones and the Dial of Destiny, is directing a Dawn of the Jedi movie.
Yeah.
Which I'm not going to get excited for that yet, because I don't believe it's happening. But if that happens, I'd be very excited for it. But Owen, also, what do you think about these two movies?
I would love to see a Dawn of the Jedi movie. Also, perhaps a Dawn of the Sith, being about Exar Kun. He was the wielder of the first double-bladed lightsaber,
mm-hmm.
and he was a great duelist. When the Jedi finally caught up to him on Yavin 4 in his temple, which would later be used by the rebels, they took him out, and I think it might have been repurposed by the Sith during the Old Republic.
Yeah, I mean, I think that would be a like really cool bit of lore. At the same time, though, I've always kind of jumped between the feeling that, you know, movies about the Jedi and the Sith, and same thing with TV shows, are really awesome, and, you know, I love obviously like seeing lightsabers and the Force being used, but at the same time, sometimes I feel like maybe Star Wars just needs a complete refresh, you know, And a lot of people saw, you know, Andor in a very positive light, saw Solo in a less positive light, I see it in a very positive light. The box office may say differently, but I think both those movies, or sorry, that movie and then that TV show do very, very well without the use of force-wielding characters, right?
Yeah. I don't know. And we'll talk more about this later on in the show, but I really want to see them move more toward, like, you know, I don't need to see a bunch of, like, spinoffs about characters we already know. Like, I want to see different...
Exactly.
Like,
a new stuff.
That's what Mysterious was great about characters. Mandalorian. That was what was great about Rogue One. That's what is going to be great about The Acolyte. And, I mean, Andor, in a sense, because, yes, even though we'd already seen that character movie, we didn't really ever get to know him, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah, the more mysterious characters kind of... I would say Yoda's more mysterious. We don't know.
But Yoda's also been in the franchise for the last almost 44 years.
Yeah. Now. We just still, even then, we don't know much about him.
Yeah. But I mean, you gotta remember also, like, there are a lot of movies for every single studio that go into development. Doesn't mean, like, even with the current state of Lucasfilm, right? Like, even if, like, we were still getting one movie per year,
mm-hmm.
I don't know if a Jabba movie would have necessarily been on the docket, you know, because
it's not there, very necessary.
I feel
it'll be
like
interesting, but it's not that necessary.
Yeah, I would have preferred to, like, see more of, like, a Bounty Hunters type movie.
Yeah, and I think that's probably, you know, in all likelihood what that would have become. You know, mm-hmm. I could see a Solo sequel where it's like, you know, basically what Drew said, like Han and Chewie on Tatooine, kind of building up their repertoire of skills and connections in the criminal underworld, and maybe Jabba's like the main head honcho of that, you know? But I don't think, like, a movie with Jabba the Hutt as a protagonist would be kind of weird. But, you know, what does he do? He sits in his, you know, whatever palace he's currently
speaking
using.
Hutties for two and a half hours.
And I mean,
boring.
I remember when Book of Boba Fett came out, like, I was super excited to, like, sort of see, like, what that sort of, like, Outer Rim underworld looked like. Because we already kind of knew what that looked like on Coruscant from, like, Clone Wars and stuff.
We didn't get much of it, but we did see
a bit of it. Like, all we really got was, like, I'm going to walk into, like, every episode of that show was, I'm going to walk into town and I'm going to say that I am, and then I'm going to go up to the Majordomo and... Yeah, you know, it was just...
And then I'm going to... And then Mando season 3 starts.
Yeah. It wasn't much
of a
show.
Like, but 2 episodes.
Yeah. I don't know. I would have loved to see maybe what Goyer's script for a Dawn of the Jedi movie was. I do hope we get a movie like that from James Mangold. But, yeah. I am just... kind of sad that we didn't get these, but not too sad.
Mm-hmm.
When we come back, we're going to be talking about what we can expect from Andor season 2. It's no secret to anyone who's been watching the show for some time that Andor is my favorite Star Wars live action thing ever. Ahsoka, I think, is going to get close if they can nail the finale next week, but I think it's safe to say that Andor is my favorite. And I recently rewatched Andor, and I did Rogue One right after. So, and I noticed a couple of things that I think can really be explored and delved into. And I will say, I did notice one little plot hole. And I'm going to say that. In the scene where Cassian and Baze and Chirrut are with Saw Gerrera and they're sort of like in the prison in Rogue One.
Mm-hmm.
Chirrut says there is more than one sort of prison. I sense you, or no, he's like, basically Cassian says this is the first cage for me, which anyone who's seen Andor knows that's not true.
Mm-hmm.
As there's that wonderful prison arc in that series.
Yeah.
I'm still watching it with you. Yeah. You gotta watch more, Drew.
We have to watch more Andor. It's wonderful. So here are the, I think, top 5 things that I think we need to see in Andor season two, and the first one has already been confirmed. We need to see the first meeting with K2SO.
Agreed.
For sure.
He was completely absent from the first season. And he's obviously, I mean, he is the Chewbacca to Cassian's Han Solo.
Yeah.
Right?
I mean, that's, yeah, basically like, what it's meant to mirror.
K2 was one of my favorite parts of Rogue One. And I think that, you know, like, seeing him come back in, like, the season premiere and sort of that story, I think would be really strong. Now, there was actually a comic back in, I think, 2017 that details the first meeting between Cassian and K2. Do you guys think that they're going to keep that, or do you think they're going to retcon it? Because they have been retconning some smaller details from the books and the comics recently.
I don't consider comics canon. There's too much.
I mean, I think that is kind of bold. I don't know. To me, there's a lot of potential to just use what has been put out in the comics and either directly adapt it for the show or, you know, take some of the cool parts of it and put it in the show. You know, we've seen that with a lot of different media recently. I think we also saw that with Rebels, with a lot of, you know, ideas. Well,
in season one of Andor, in the visual dictionary for Rogue One, it mentions that Cassian's homeworld is Fest. Where in the show, it's a big thing where he's from this planet, Canary. But what they were able to do with that...
Isn't his cover Fest?
Yeah, was Marva says, we've always said Fest. Every official document says Fest. So they were able to sort of marry those two things together in a great way. And I wonder if that's what we're going to see with K2. Number two, more side characters from the Battle of Scarif in Rogue One. We saw Melshi in the prison arc, who is just a super minor character in Rogue One, and I really want to see season two kind of bring forth more of those just extras. Yeah. Bring them back, give them their backstories, like make us care about them, so that then when we see them in on the Battle of Scarif, like we have personal connections with all these characters. I really want to see more Tivik.
Yeah.
Tivik, what was the character at the beginning of Rogue One, who sort of tells Cassian about Bodhi, and you know that was the moment where we knew Rogue One was gonna be a very different Star Wars movie, because like we see Cassian shoot an ally, and we'd never seen that Star Wars before. But yeah, that's number two. Number three, more Saw Gerrera.
I have not seen Saw Gerrera yet.
Yeah, Saw Gerrera pops up in two episodes of season one. Two great episodes of season one. He's great stuff. But in season, but when we get to Rogue One, we know that Saw was a part of the early days of this official Rebel alliance, and
we see that in Rebels too.
Yeah, I really want to see that explored. Saw Gerrera is, I think, a wonderful character to have in Star Wars. I love seeing him pop up, whether it's in
Clone Wars,
Rebels. Bad Batch, Rebels, Fallen Order, Rogue One, Andor.
I always forget which media piece was the first that he showed up in.
Clone Wars.
In he
because I know
in Clone Wars season 5.
Yeah, when he is young with his sister.
Yeah, voiced by Andrew Kishino, who reprised the role in the first season of Bad Batch. But yeah, more Saw Gerrera, and then, of course, the founding of the Rebel Alliance. This is sort of what this whole series was built around. Was in live action, you're going to see the foundings of the Rebel Alliance that we see in A New Hope, Empire, and Jedi.
Yeah.
I think it's going to be a really big deal. We're going to see Bail Organa come in. We're going to see General Draven come in and more of those characters from Rogue One. Maybe
General Draven.
Draven was in Rogue One.
He's the guy who like ordered the...
Yeah. General Draven's already blown up an Imperial base. A decision needed to be made. But yeah, more
Star Wars
of those,
fans don't attack me. I'm working my way through Andor. Don't attack me.
Well, that was from Rogue One. That was a lot.
Yeah, I am kind of missing.
Okay, we'll do like a 40-hour marathon with Owen.
Yes,
to refresh.
Please. All right, yeah. And then the last one. Continue the slow burn aspect from season one that made that so wonderful, but also give us more connection to the wider Star Wars mythology. Like I think that what we kind of need to see in season two is The season two is happening concurrently with Rebels, with all four seasons, because it's going to span 4 years.
The thing I did notice that did connect to the rest of Star Wars is the Rakata thing, which was the Rakata, like, emblem or whatever in one of the first few episodes of Andor.
Yeah.
But which, like, I did like. That's a thing from KOTOR and
I think,
I'm going to call Old Republic or...
Yeah. I think we're going to see, honestly, Ezra's message out to the galaxy. I really think we're awesome. Going to see that in this season. Guys, just real quick, Angus, what do you want to see from Andor season two?
I think I'm with you with the slow burn. I think that's what most fans loved. You know, that was kind of just the general population's one of the favorite parts of that series was it wasn't the same sort of pacing and tone as past Star Wars shows. But I would really like to see a lot of, like, missions. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because I think the difference was in Andor Season 1, it was really focused on, like, just following Cassian around wherever he was kind of forced to go. And I think seeing him start to go on more missions, like, for Luthen and for the Rebel Alliance would be really cool. So,
yeah.
I don't think... I haven't seen Andor Season 1,
so... you're about a third of the way through it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cannot wait. We will be right back, right after this talk about Skeleton Crew.
We have this musical interlude brought to you by RFR listener Hunter Chambers. Fire it off and rip.
My name is Jay Mack. This is my buddy Swank. We're RFR, and honestly, it's pretty great. So let me tell you about the Star Wars podcast. We got anything and everything to do with news, conversations, and laughs. Oh, we got Puppet Lando. We got Hog Squaddle. Throw Puppet Zero in the mix, and you got lightning in a bottle. Interviews with the Clone Wars crew. Catch at Matt, Steve, and Stan. By the way, fun fact, did you know that Jason lives in Canton? More interviews than anybody with Dave Filoni. Honest after shows. No shills here. No baloney. And if you don't agree with what we have to say, lock us up on Narkina, we'll find the one way out to escape. Except for maybe Swank and my man Kino Loy, cause they both can't swim, but maybe survival instincts will be employed. We don't like Han talking Wookiee, nor Peli talking frog. Don't talk bad about Baby Yoda, or we'll have to cast you off. But alright, this song is done. Let's get to listening and have some fun. So grab some Jawa juice and a flag and a spotka. Relax, hang loose, you know Rebel Force Radio gotcha.
So, as Ahsoka draws to a close in next week, it's time to start looking at what is the next Star Wars series coming to Disney Plus, and that is Skeleton Crew. But we don't know much about this show yet. It's very under wraps right now. Like, we don't
know
character names. Yeah, so we're gonna go through that right now. So, Skeleton Crew, what we know so far. So here's the official synopsis from Disney. Skeleton Crew follows the journey of four kids who make a mysterious discovery on their seemingly safe home planet, then get lost in a strange and dangerous galaxy. Finding their way home and meeting unlikely allies and enemies will be a greater adventure than they ever imagined.
It's the Goonies.
Well, that brings us to the next thing. Or that is not the next thing, but we'll talk about that later. Here's the cast. We have no character names yet. All we know about Jude Law's character is that he's playing a Force user.
Ooh.
And that's all we know about in these characters. But Ravi Cabot-Conyers, Kiriana Cratter, Robert Timothy Smith, and Ryan Kira Armstrong, they are all young actors. They're all, you know, in that sort of like maybe 13 to 15 range.
Mm-hmm.
Ryan Armstrong is like the only one who has credits from being in this movie last year based on a Stephen King novel, Firestarter, which I heard the movie wasn't very good.
Who did Jude Law play in Captain Marvel and
Fantastic? Yon Rogg. So he was Yon Rogg in Captain Marvel, and then he's Dumbledore in the Fantastic Beasts films.
So it's more like an older group.
Yeah, the only
like 40s.
Yeah, the only other name on this list I recognize is Carrie Condon from Banshees of Inisherin. Angus, I'm not sure if you saw the film. It is wonderful. It was up for several Oscars last year. She was nominated for Best Supporting Actress.
Isn't that about the two old guys just arguing?
Yes. Highly recommend. It is actually a very great film.
All right.
So you did mention Goonies. One of the first things you knew about this show when it was first reported back in like May of 2022 is that it's inspired by Amblin films of the 1980s, like E.T., Goonies, Back to the Future, Gremlins. Yeah, very, you know, all films that...
Like adventure films.
Yes, yeah, so that like Spielberg worked on in the 80s.
I think it would be interesting to see Star Wars in this light, just like hunting. Yeah.
I mean, I would sort of think this show is going to be...
Archaeology. Indiana Jones, but in space.
Is going to be kind of like Ms. Marvel, which is a show that I really liked, which is a show that is not a kid's show, but it is targeted at, you know, maybe the...
Tween audience.
I think this is what Star Wars... This is something that Star Wars could thrive in. Star Wars has always been for kids.
Yeah. I think it definitely seems like it has a lot of potential for younger audiences. I think it could also be really nostalgic for, you know, older audiences who actually, like, grew up with those films.
Oh, yeah.
Especially if it sort of retains maybe not the same aesthetic, but the same vibes and sort of tone as those films. I think that'd be really awesome. Like, I love... I mean, literally every film on that list, I think, is awesome.
Yeah. E.T. is probably in my top 15 of all time. Yeah.
Top, wonderful film. Top number one cameo in episode 3. When E.T. shows up.
In episode 1. He was in episode 1.
Oh, episode 1. In episode 3. The Senate.
We do also have our director's list.
John Watts. That name.
We have John Watts, who is hot off the MCU Spider-Man trilogy.
Oh, yeah.
We have... the reigning best directors in the world, following Everything Ever All at Once, the Daniels. We have David Lowery. I don't know any of his credits off the top of my head. Jake Schreier is directing the upcoming Marvel film, Thunderbolts. Obviously, she is like 3 for 4 right now in terms of great episodes. Bryce Dallas Howard's coming back.
Yeah.
Chapter 4, Sanctuary. Chapter 11, The Heiress, and Chapter 5 of the Book of Fett, all wonderful episodes of Star Wars TV. Her episode of Mando Season 3 wasn't so great, but the rest of her episodes are great. Oh, and she did the Jack Black and Lizzo episode.
Oh.
Which, that episode had a terrible script, but like, still. And then Lee Isaac Chung is coming back from Mando Season 3. I believe he directed... The Foundling episode. No. He did the Coruscant episode, which
that would have been great had it been connected.
That was
to
a
you.
Wonderfully directed episode, though.
It had nothing to do with season three.
Qualms with that.
I
think it does have to do with the Mandalorian too.
I think we're going to see that sort of pay off in the next season.
Exactly.
I think something's going to
The Dr. Pershing stuff, I think, 1,000% ties into, like, Moff Gideon's efforts to clone, you know, Grogu and all that. So I think it is linking in with the rest of the story. Obviously, like Owen said, though, wasn't exactly joined in. But, yeah. I get the point. I think all of these directors are very experienced and usually very effective people. So,
And then the last thing. Favreau and Filoni are executive producers on this show. I do believe this will tie in with Mando and Boba Fett and Ahsoka. Maybe not, like, a lot. Like, I think we're going to see, like, Jude Law pop up in the movie. But I don't know if we'll see these kids necessarily.
Yeah.
Filoni is cooking when it comes to Ahsoka.
He is, but he's cooking some gas. He's not writing the show. He's not directing the show. He's just a producer on it.
And producers, I mean, they have influence, but writers and directors do decide a lot. And I think
Steven Spielberg produced all the Transformers movies, and those movies are...
I think it really is up to, you know, I've noticed a lot of the Star Wars community recently is like just praising Filoni like a god king. I think he's awesome, but I think it's also due in part to the whole, you know, every filmmaker in that project. So
when we come back, the writer's strike is finally over. after 148 days, the 2023 Writers Guild of America strike has come to an end. And I have the deal right here, the summary from the official WGA website on what the writers are getting. The actor strike is still ongoing. They have their...
Isn't it about to end, though? Like, there's a meeting with AMPTP?
They have their first meeting scheduled for Monday. Mm. And, I mean, the writers got their deal done. I mean, they first met on Wednesday the 20th. And the strike ended on Wednesday the 27th. So we could...
Oh, that's pretty efficient, actually.
I really think... I mean, maybe... Maybe not by next week's episode, but the episode after that. I really do think we're going to be talking about how the writers, how both strikes are over and the industry can finally get going again. But, so let's talk, so do you guys have any, what do you guys want to hear me say first about the strike and sort of the protections and the stuff they got? What do you want to?
All of it.
I think specifically, if you could just do like a quick rundown on the benefits so like that the strikers have received?
And then residuals.
So residuals is the thing we're saying. All right, so I'll do the residuals first. It's between that and AI stuff. So residuals, they have a, for the weekly pay increase, it's, I mean, for staff writers and stuff, it's a raise about 5%. So if you're working on a show for up to 9 weeks as a staff writer, you're going to be making $11,000 per week.
Wow.
If you're working if you're a staff writer on a show for 10 to 19 weeks, it's $9,500. And if it's 20 plus weeks, then it's $8,500. So, that makes sense. I mean, that you're not going to be doing more if you're on it for more time, because that would... I mean, this is actually a really great deal, because the writers, their first, like, contract was, like, for, I think, $450 million. What the studios countered with was about $85 million, and this is a deal that's about $250 million. So that's just a really great deal. Both sides compromised.
Yeah, and they got it right in the middle there.
Yeah,
that's great.
So then if we're gonna talk about the writers' room, because this was a big thing, was people were writing entire seasons of television by themselves on an unrealistic deadline. So if you have six or fewer episodes, you have to have at least three writers in the writer's room.
All right.
If you have 7 to 12 episodes, now we're talking about all these new Star Wars shows, right?
Yeah.
You need at least five writers.
Which means Marvel's only getting three writers in a room.
Yeah.
Unfortunately.
But Daredevil Born Again is going to be 18 episodes. So, and if you have 13 or more episodes in your season, that's six writers in your writer's room.
Wow.
Which... I mean, just imagine having to write, I mean, 12 episodes in, like, 14 or 15 weeks by yourself. Like, that is...
Yeah, I mean, I think the... Obviously, the surface issue is, like, that's a big stress on one person. But looking at just the changes now, I think not only will it relieve the stress, but it's going to bring another massive benefit, which is it opens up a lot more jobs for... writers, right? Mm-hmm. Instead of being shut out of these big projects, these, you know, Disney projects, HBO or Max projects, or, you know, Amazon, Netflix, whatever, now a lot more writers will have the opportunity to write on these shows and to, you know, get a name for themselves, get connections, get experience.
So, yeah, absolutely. So for AI, which was a big thing, was AI. No, AI cannot write or rewrite literary material, and AI-generated material will not be considered source material under the MBA, meaning that AI-generated material cannot be used to undermine a writer's credit or separate rights. So basically what that means is...
No AI, no ChatGPT.
No. So they talk about that later. A writer can use AI to...
Get ideas.
Get some ideas. To sort of say... give me a rough outline for a Mace Windu movie. Mm-hmm. And AI could generate that. And then if you write a script based on that, it's not going to say, like, Windu, a Star Wars story written by Angus Allan based on a story by ChatGPT. Mm-hmm. You get full credit for it.
I think using AI to get ideas is perfectly okay, as long as you don't, like, just go with the ideas and just don't fully make use it. Use it for examples. Yeah. Use it for ideas.
Yeah.
If you're using it to, like, cheat on, like, a slideshow, don't do that, of course. If you're using it to get ideas for a slideshow, that is completely different.
Mm-hmm. Angus?
Yeah, no, I think Owen's point definitely makes sense. But I would have to disagree, because I think, you know, I want to make it, like, abundantly clear, I'm not a writer. If someone asked me from Disney or you know, Warner Brothers or something to write a show or a movie, I would be lost. And I would probably write, like, a third grade level story. But as someone who loves movies and loves books, I've written a lot of, you know, of little scripts, a lot of little outlines and stuff, and just generally tried to you know, try my hand at story writing.
Yeah.
And I can say, and I'm sure anyone who has tried the same, that it's very easy to try to get AI to give you ideas and stuff, or to you know, take inspiration from some of your favorite source material. But you find out that oftentimes that source material, or, you know, in the case of AI, the AI ideas, can really, really heavily influence what you end up writing, to the point where it's not necessarily your creative work. And I think that's the slippery slope. Because I think, like you said, it could turn out being, you know, they're just using it for ideas and it's all good. It could turn out for some writers where they're very heavily influenced by the AI.
Using it to cheat.
So I think it's good that the writers have accomplished their demands. But I think maybe some of those demands should have been adjusted, or the way that it was worded in the contract adjusted.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I should be clear, the official contract's like 95 pages. Yeah. I just have the 2-page summary up.
Yeah.
But
20-hour Tusken episode coming soon. Let's go through the entire contract. Yeah.
So in terms of residuals, there will be residuals for streaming. The studios will be, through non-disclosure agreements, they will be supplying the unions with streaming numbers, stuff that the public does not get, right?
What are streaming numbers?
Basically, how many people watched this week's episode of Ahsoka, or how many people watched The Empire Strikes Back.
And based on that...
Or how many people watched... Morbius, you know, on Netflix. So the viewership-based streaming hours. Made for streaming series and films that are viewed by 20% or more of the service's domestic subscribers in the first 90 days of release, or in the first 90 days in any subsequent exhibition year, get a bonus equal to 50% of the fixed domestic and foreign residual.
Everyone, tell your friends, start watching new shows.
For
that
instance,
way, they get so much more money.
For instance, projects written under the new MBA on the largest streaming services would receive a bonus of $9,000 for a half-hour episode, $16,000 for a one-hour episode, or $40,500 for a streaming feature over $30 million in budget. And this will go into effect on the first of the year. And this is the last thing I'll say. Premium for pilot and backup scripts, 150% pilot premium and 115% backup script premiums will now apply to programs made for high-budget streaming video on demand.
Wow. I guess the really only question I have, like, left with the contract is, do the streaming residuals apply to apps like YouTube?
No. It's only for anything covered by the AMPTP. So okay. Disney, Netflix, Warner, Universal, Paramount, Apple, Amazon.
All right.
Sony.
Posting movies in a million parts with the Subway Surfers clips underneath it does not, unfortunately,
I think
give residuals.
That would also be extremely hard to regulate. So
I get that. Yeah, so they got their deal. Actors are going to start the negotiations on Monday. When we come back, we will be pitching some Star Wars films. We'll be right back.
As we were just talking about, we all have ideas about Star Wars shows and movies and projects. What are some ideas that you have, Angus?
Well, I think in terms of, you know, projects that I would love to write and create, I've always thought it would be really awesome to do, kind of like we were mentioning about briefly earlier, some sort of film that takes place in a time where the Jedi and the Sith aren't as influential. You can focus more on like the Outer Rim and stuff. And I think not resorting to two cliches, which is having a Force wielder and then having like a classic bounty hunter character, would be awesome, right? And I know there's a new video game coming out. I'm blanking on the name.
Outlaws?
Yes, Star Wars Outlaws. So that one, I think, seems really cool because as far as we know, it's a completely original story, original characters. I think something like that would be awesome. Also, I think doing a story about, I don't know, this is like really random idea I had, but basically there's a sort of Indiana Jones type archaeologist, could be like a young person, could be super old and wise, kind of Gandalf-y. But they're going around these big kind of uninhabited planets, these jungle planets, desert planets, you know, mountainous areas, and basically trying to uncover the secrets and the history of, like, the Star Wars galaxy, not just the Jedi and the Sith, but everything. So, yeah.
Owen?
My ideas for some Star Wars things are, like, a sequel to Solo. We never, or, like, stuff about Darth Maul. We never got to see what ended up happening with the Shadow Collective, because really badass name. Nothing came of it. I think we also do need to step out of originals, prequels, and sequels. Maybe go further back. I'm talking Knights of the Old Republic, High Republic, Dawn of the Jedi.
Yeah.
Stuff like that will be really interesting. And, of course, I'm a big fan of Darth Revan, as the rest of the Star Wars community is. But he just is a really awesome character. That's, like, the exact balance between light and dark.
Ray did it first. Ray Skywalker.
I mean,
Skywalker.
I've literally been writing down Star Wars stories since I was in fourth grade, when the Force Awakens came out.
Oh, I wrote down a Maul fan script. That.
Yeah,
I wrote down a Maul fan script.
I wrote an entire script based on the Jude Watson book, The Desperate Mission, about Kenobi.
You wrote one
but
about
an idea that I've been kicking around lately is an idea that would very much step out of the Skywalker saga era, which I think Star Wars desperately needs to do. It's set like 8,000 years after Episode 9.
Wait, what about the two Lego sets?
I told you about this one. It's called Droid City, and it's an idea that I had. Where like there was, I mean, Star Wars has kind of shown in the past, like, especially with L3 and in this most recent episode of Ahsoka, mere droids, right? That people don't really love droids all that much in Star Wars, right? What happens if the droids just say, enough is enough, and there's, like, a droid uprising? But this isn't the story about that. This story about what happens after the droids lose the war and every droid in the galaxy is sent to this one planet. And it's called Droid City. And that's basically all I'm going to say here, because I am actually very excited about the story. I don't want to, like, give enough details to anybody to, like, plagiarize my stuff.
Look out, Kathleen Kennedy. Yeah, I mean, to me, it's giving me, like, emoji movie, but I'm kidding. I think that's a really cool idea. I think it's got a lot of potential for cool lore. I think that'd be really awesome. But
I'm still working on this. I made a D&D like Star Wars game called Tuskens and Dragons with 11 different classes, a new campaign for each, And I think I got really far into the first one, over halfway. I just need to start working on it again.
That's pretty solid.
I mean, also, I'd love to see anything with the Yuuzhan Vong.
Yeah.
Anything, like, Yuuzhan Vong.
Filoni-verse movie might happen.
I don't think so. Like, because I think Yuuzhan Vong is such a huge thing. You can't just do that just in between, like, haphazardly. In between the Empire and the First Order. I think if you're going to do Yuuzhan Vong, maybe that could be something that, like, starts to emerge in the Rey Skywalker movie.
You know what I just realized would be really cool? A Yuuzhan Vong versus the Chiss.
That could Star be cool. Trek in Star Wars. No, I think that'd be cool, though.
Yeah.
Because it's like two crazy invader species.
Yeah.
All right. Well, when we come back, we are going to be talking about Ahsoka, Part 7, Dreams and Madness. Right after this.
And we're back. This time, we're going to be reviewing Episode 7, Dreams and Madness, which I believe is a Balin Skull quote, right? From a previous episode.
I believe it was, yes.
This is the land of dreams and madness.
However, but not too much dreams or madness.
Yeah, that's what Owen was noting. You know, not really too much of that. I think there was a lot of madness, though. You know, obviously, we've seen a very interesting character arc with Balin over the past few episodes, you know, once they've gotten to Peridia, where he's kind of maybe slowly but surely revealing plans of his own for the galaxy, plans of his own for Shin and, you know, his ambitions. So just first, before we talk about Balin and Shin's scenes in this episode, I think first just talking about Ahsoka and Huyang arriving in the new galaxy was really
full
cool.
Full spoiler alert for this episode.
You immediately said Yuuzhan Vong.
Anyways, so I think that was a really cool arrival because it was almost like I forget what it's called, situational irony maybe, where the audience knows that Thrawn has told them to shoot down the Purrgil, but Ahsoka and Huyang have no idea if Thrawn's even there, yeah. Right? So
they got that answer.
Yeah, I mean, they figured out pretty quickly, and then there's that awesome chase scene. We, of course, saw Thrawn's, like, tactics come into play, which I thought was really cool. Mm-hmm. And I think also what's really interesting to me is we see him implementing, just like how he has the Night Troopers that are clearly influenced by the Great Mothers?
Yeah, the
Great Mothers. But also just his battle tactics are very kind of reliant and influenced on the Great Mothers and their magic skills.
What do you call them?
Okay.
My best impression of a Thrawn.
You know what? I think there's a lot to love about this episode. I think for me, though, this is my least favorite episode of the entire show so far.
Agreed.
I just felt like this episode had a lot of conveniences in it, you know? Like, literally, they've been chasing Ezra for the last 10 years, and now everyone just happens to find him in like one day.
Yeah.
Like that to me is...
What are the chances we're in the right galaxy? What are the chances that we even get to the right planet?
That part's fine because it's like been established that was like where the Purrgil go, right? Was to Peridia. But I just felt... I mean, there was that. There was the stuff on Coruscant. Loved seeing C-3PO back, played again by Anthony Daniels. I thought that stuff on Coruscant was pretty bad, though. Just in terms of, like, writing, like, this is not how, like, Senate hearings work.
Mm-hmm. It's with the hosts.
I can understand that point, but at the same time, when George Lucas was writing the prequels, he clearly did not understand how the U.S. Senate worked.
That is very fair.
Or you know what? Because I think sometimes Star Wars fans, we can be very obsessive. We often have, you know, some sort of, you know, obsessive kind of quality about us. Yes. Whoa, yes, wow, Drew, really? We do.
Star Wars fans are passionate.
But I think I think the truth is sometimes we kind of forget that, you know, it's a galaxy far, far away a long time ago, right?
Oh, yeah.
things are going to be different. There are magic monks, and there are weird reptile people and monkey people and everything. Like
the reptile, the
I think you know for there to be slightly different like Senate processes, I think is fine. You know, the one qualm that I did have with that scene that I will probably agree with you on is I forget the character's name. He's the guy who's always trying to get it.
Oh, Ziono?
Yeah. I hate that guy.
I think Kaz's his
dad.
I hate that dude.
I mean, yeah, I think I they've accomplished getting the audience to hate him. I don't know if it's because of his character building, though, or because he's very one-dimensional. I think probably because he's one-dimensional, though, because he just, his entire thing is like, I'm going to get you, Hera.
Yeah.
And then he gets, like, shut down by C-3PO, and he's like, oh, okay.
I mean, and look.
He's a droid. It doesn't count.
I liked this episode. Like, this, I think, to me, is, like, a solid, like, 6.5, 7 out of 10.
Yeah.
I like it. I think it's just a step down from the first 6 episodes. I'm a little worried that there's only one episode left. And there's...
Don't jinx it.
I feel like there's a lot that they have to do.
How long is it supposed to be?
We don't know. No, yet. I'm really hoping for like an hour long episode.
2 hours.
If it's gonna be
40-hour episode.
If it's gonna be a 35-minute episode next week,
I'm gonna not watch it.
How long was the Mando season finale?
The season finales have generally been longer. Like I believe they've all been in like that 1 hour range.
Yeah. So I would say that generally, like if you look at the past year and a half, 2 years of Star Wars shows, the finales have usually been at the very least adequate, right?
Yeah.
Maybe they haven't been like the most wonderful thing in the world. They didn't meet everyone's little expectations. But even just look at a show like Game of Thrones as comparison, right? Everyone had massive expectations for that finale. And at the time, it wasn't very pleasing to a lot of people. They felt like there were some things missing. I've seen the same thing with Mando Season 3's finale. But I think as time goes on, you kind of look back at it and you're like, okay, they tied up most of the loose ends. Yeah. It was a decent episode. And I think that's what this finale will be.
And we'll talk more about this in the predictions segment, but I mean, honestly, the only finale that I didn't love for a Star Wars show was Boba Fett. Like, Kenobi, I thought that was the best part of the whole show. For Andor, oh my god.
The Andor finale was great.
The Andor finale with this Marva's hologram filling the streets of Ferrix. I just felt it was awesome. But
Drew's...
I would not know.
Drew's very excited about Andor, but...
Yeah.
You know what I just realized?
Fight.
Yeah.
A absolute god-tier team-up, Moff Gideon and Thrawn. But Moff Gideon is... dead. I still think he's a clone.
Oh, speaking of characters being dead, how is that great little thing when like Sabine's like catching Ezra up, and Ezra's like, "And the Emperor died." That's what people say. I love that.
I actually kind of chuckled at that one, because I think, you know, what people don't necessarily understand is that Filoni and all the producers, you know, and directors and writers of these new shows, the Filoniverse shows, they're not trying to erase the sequels, no. But I think they're trying to build something different that can still be a post Return of the Jedi kind of story that's cohesive, that makes sense, that's also, you know, not completely overshadowing
the sequels. It's the same thing that Clone Wars did for the prequel films.
Exactly.
And I've been saying that since Mando Season 2. Like, I feel like these shows are helping to flesh out the sequels and make them better, and God knows that they need that.
Yeah.
I want to look at the sequels and say this is as good Star Wars as, you know, the prequel films.
Yeah.
The Ezra, you called it again. Dude, you're like you are like four for five. You're like honestly 4 for 5 on predictions for this show.
With this spot on predictions from last episode, and then the calling the Force Karate for the last 3 episodes.
Yeah,
I think I just kind of thought of it like, you know, in this sort of vein. If he doesn't have his lightsaber, and it's a hostile, you know, evil, just crazy wasteland, he clearly has to have some sort of battle skills to survive. And kind of, I felt going with the sort of samurai classic East Asian vibe of, you know, classic East Asian film that's been going with this. You already had the sort of Kurosawa samurai film.
This episode was so Kurosawa.
Yeah.
It was so Kurosawa.
And now they've sort of taken it and added in like the classic Chinese films with kung fu and sort of, you know, martial arts. So I think that's a very interesting aspect.
My only nitpick of it was, like, I don't, like, it's kind of hard to understand how force karate works. It's kind of just like karate with just like force push.
If it's relevant, they'll flesh it out. Yeah. I've been, like, I mean, look, I was always someone when I was playing with my Star Wars toys. I mean,
even force karate,
even as far back as like last night. When I was doing battles with my action figures, like, I would always
still do
lose
battles
the lightsabers, you know?
Yeah.
And I'd be like, oh, they can use the force on each other now, you know?
Yeah. Exactly.
Oh, if I do that, like, I don't know if this is an unpopular opinion. I'm not huge on the Thrawn in this show so far. Like, Thrawn, in this show, I feel is just evil for being evil. You know, I don't really feel as though he has any nuance to him or anything. But yeah, other than that,
I would agree. I think, as my kind of final point of review, I think the episode overall was good. I liked that Baylan was just sort of, like, smug about telling Shin to go, you know, fight Ezra and Sabine. Like, yeah, go do it. She was like, what? And then, you know, whatever. But besides that, I think Thrawn, because he's not serving a boss, you know, like Palpatine, he's on his own. His circumstances are different, and I think that does change how he's portrayed. But yeah,
I mean, last time he was on his own was when he first joined the Empire, and he completely destroyed a whole like civilization.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Fun.
Yeah, I think we'll see more of him in the next episode, but we will be right back with the next segment.
So we all have predictions for the next episode, the finale of Ahsoka. What are you thinking, Drew?
I still believe Thrawn has to kill somebody. Thrawn has to come into the galaxy, the main galaxy, and those filthy casuals who've only watched the live action stuff, they need to understand.
They need to be
why
scared.
Why Thrawn is such a big deal. And I believe that we are going to see Thrawn, like, decimate something.
He's going to decimate, like, an entire New Republic fleet. And imagine him rejoining the new Empire.
Yeah. I think that Carson Teva is dead next episode.
Me too.
I've been predicting that for the last two episodes now, that Carson Teva is going to die. I believe he served his purpose in this story. You know, he's been the one who's kind of been warning the New Republic since Mando season 2 that there is something else out there. These acts of, you know, Imperial remnants in the Outer Rim, they are not
meaningless.
They are all connected. There's something larger here. And now that, like, that something larger is coming with Thrawn, I like his purpose is done in this Mandoverse. I do believe he's going to die. Angus?
Mm-hmm. With that prediction specifically, I think we've already talked about this. I'm not 100% sure. I think I definitely agree with you on the fact that Thrawn will probably destroy, you know, some sort of installation in the New Republic. You know, I would assume Hera has been working in Coruscant to rally a fleet to go stop Thrawn. That fleet's probably going to arrive as he's coming back. Battle. Thrawn destroys them. That kind of makes sense, right?
He decimated.
Carson could die. We'll see. But I think, as for my predictions, it's sort of split up into, like, the Thrawn and, you know, Ahsoka sort of predictions, and then the, like, Baylan and Shin predictions.
Mm-hmm.
And specifically with the Ahsoka and Thrawn, I think we're basically just going to see Ahsoka do even more to try to stop Thrawn from leaving. I think next episode is going to feel like a very desperate kind of drive to, mm-hmm. at the last minute, stop him from leaving with his army.
Which they will, of course, fail.
Yeah, kind of like Empire Strikes Back, right?
So
I think that Ahsoka will probably battle Morgan, because I just have a feeling we haven't seen Morgan have a lot of combat. I thought her fight with Ahsoka in Mando Season 2 was really cool.
Oh, wait, that was her.
Yeah.
Oh, I forgot.
And so I think to see her battle again, maybe with more Night Sister powers, would be awesome. And then as for Baylan, just really, I hope that they give us a hint. He doesn't have to have all his loose ends tied up, but I hope they give us some sort of hint with where he's going forward, because they kind of just cut off from him in the last episode and didn't really elaborate.
What do you think he is the calling that is being heard? Because it's scaring away Thrawn.
The calling? Oh,
the calling. I'm calling it the calling. Sounds cool.
I mean, honestly, I think that is probably has to do with Palpatine and Exegol.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Like, if it's scaring away Thrawn, then I think that Project Necromancer and what Palpatine is doing in the Unknown Regions with building up the Final Order, like, that would be a direct threat to Thrawn's power.
But this isn't in the Unknown
completely
Regions.
Completely different. Scaring. It's in a completely different galaxy.
Okay, so...
And it's calling to Baylan from that galaxy. Oh.
Could it be the Yuuzhan Vong? Like, it could be something brand new. Something brand new. But if I'm thinking about, like, what has been established in Star Wars lore...
The Rikata.
I don't know if they're going to bring that in.
I don't know. Okay,
to
me...
The Rikata did invade, and, like, there's a whole infection.
So, guys, to me, what makes the most sense is not a character or an essence or a being of some sort, but a resource or a material or some sort of physical non-living object, because I think that that's something Filoni could use in the movie as a central sort of point of contention, central sort of, you know, thing that's going on, basically like a MacGuffin. But, you know, it could be some sort of extremely powerful mineral, like a new form of Kyber that Baylan knows he can use to create a new superweapon. It could be some sort of, something along the lines of that, or a very, very ancient force-related temple. You know, maybe an old Night Sister temple that he can utilize to strengthen his powers to make himself basically a living god.
Right.
Because his whole thing with Shin, I noticed in this last episode, was he's talking about, you know, unlocking your own potential and seizing your own ambition and patience. Because Shin has been very impatient. She's just been focusing on trying to jump in. And Baylan's playing the long game. And I think he knows that maybe something has led him to here. And he can use that to realize his ambition. But he has to be patient.
The only thing is, if it was a new form of Kyber, why would that be scaring away Thrawn?
Well, I think the scaring away Thrawn thing isn't necessarily accurate, right?
Red herring.
His whole like thing is, I want to leave. I've been stuck on here long enough.
But why not just take over that galaxy?
Because there's nothing there.
He has one.
There's
ship.
No point in staying in an empty galaxy full of nothing.
Oh, no.
Pretty much just Peridia, and that's it.
No.
We don't.
I think that it's just like Thrawn knows that this is where the Purgle go. If there is ever to be some sort of rescue attempt made for him, that. If he tries to leave that planet, and remember, he doesn't have coordinates for any other planet in this new galaxy, right? The only reason why he's there in the first place is because of the Purgil.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it makes the most sense for him to just stay where he is.
Well, yeah, but plainly, if we're talking about why he's leaving, it's because he wants to restore his own version of the Empire, yeah. Right? And he wants to do that in the main galaxy.
I mean, another thing I would like to see is what happened, like, directly after they got there.
That would be interesting. Maybe in a flashback in the future. Maybe in a comic or something. But yeah. We'll see. Overall, really hyped for the finale. We'll be back next week with news on that.
Thank you so much for watching this episode of Tusken Radio. In theaters this weekend, a new film from Rogue One director Gareth Edwards, the creator. A little low budget, relatively speaking, sci-fi film. About the war between AI and humans. And this is not sponsored anyway. I've just been incredibly excited for this movie. Like, honestly, like...
Same.
After Oppenheimer, this is my most anticipated film of the whole year.
Yeah, I really want to see it too.
I've heard nothing but, like, incredible things about it. Like, people... Like, reviews and reactions saying stuff like...
I've heard best movie
like,
here.
This is, like, all-time great sci-fi film. Like, on the same levels as, like, Terminator, Alien, Star Wars.
That's crazy.
The first Star Wars.
Well... We will have to see, though.
Yeah. I've got tickets for Saturday. I'm so excited. But thank you so much for watching Tusken Radio this week. We'll be back next week. I am Drew Grech.
I'm Owen Grech.
And I'm Angus Allan.
May the Force be with you. Always.